Hello, my name is Dr. Deborah Sutter. I'm going to demonstrate the sensory exam. Thank you to Dr. Laughlin for assisting with today's demonstration. All right, so for sensation, it's important to remember that you have your dorsal column medial lemniscus pathway that conveys position and joint position and vibration sensation. We also have our spinal thalamic tract that conveys pinprick and temperature sensation. So allow me to demonstrate how I approach the sensory exam. First, I like to check temperature sensation. It's common for neurologists to use their cold tuning fork and just touch it on the distal aspect of the arm and ask, does this feel cold to you? Comparing right to left and then on the foot. This is how I do it in a normal patient, just to make sure that cold sensation is working appropriately. If I have a patient who has abnormal sensory findings on their exam, then I want to check it a couple extra ways. So here at Mayo, we actually have these little discs, one that's kept on a cold metal shelf and the other that's kept on a little heated shelf. So that way they can test and tell you if they feel something cold or hot. So I'll have the patient close their eyes. Tell me, is it cold or hot?
Cold. Hot.
And then I could do a couple different trials to make sure that the sensation's consistent. Another thing that I'll check if someone's having issues with feeling temperature is I'll give them an area where it's normal. Typically, I'll check on the chest because it tends to be well preserved. And then I say, okay, this is cold, right? That's cold. And then there, if they can't feel it, tell me where it feels as cold as it does on the chest. And that way I can help figure out where is that sensation normalized. So that's checking temperature. Next, I go for testing vibration. If it's a normal patient, I'm just doing a quick neurological exam. I'll tap the tuning fork just a little bit to get a little vibration to hold it against the joint. It's important. I want to make sure that I'm pressing the fork to the distal interphalangeal joint, and I'm also holding my distal interphalangeal joint underneath her. So that way I can feel the vibration myself. That vibration information is going into her finger and my finger. And then I ask her, does this feel buzzy to you? If it's a little bit buzzy and she can feel it, then I feel comfortable in testing. If I really want to know vibration sensation, I'll do a large strike and then ask her to tell me when it stops. Sometimes the tuning fork can vibrate for quite a long time. So a little trick is you move your finger up a little bit and that'll get it to stop a little bit quicker. And then I'll see, is it about the same time for us? Or does she have, it extinguishes for her before it extinguishes for me? I'm using myself as a normal control. Another trick, sometimes when patients are a little bit inconsistent on the exam, sometimes I won't tap it. I'll just kind of mime that I'm tapping it to make sure, yes, they're accurate. They're telling me, okay, it's not vibrating. And then, okay, here it is vibrating. What do you feel? Is it buzzy or not buzzy? Again, I'll be sure to test in the fingers as well as the distal joint in the toe. That's vibration sensation. Next is joint position sense. So for this, positioning of the hands is very important. I want to make sure that I'm stabilizing that distal interphalangeal joint and then holding on to both ends of the finger and make sure that that patient's nice and loose as I wiggle them. I'll have the patient close their eyes and then tell me, do they feel their finger move up, down, or they don't know?
Up, down, down.
It's important to give them a couple different trials, again, to check for that consistency. There's another trick you can use is you have the patient close their eyes, and then you do really teeny movements and gradually make it bigger and bigger, and you ask the patient to tell you, when do you start to feel the movement? So eyes closed, when do you start to feel it?
No.
Yeah. Whereas if people have reduced joint position sense, they'll need much larger amplitude movements before they can feel it. I do the same technique in the fingers as I do in the toes. If someone doesn't have any joint position sense at the finger, then I need to move up the arm or move up the leg to see when do they recover joint position sense. So I can stabilize at the wrist and hold the hand, move the hand up and down. I can stabilize at the elbow, move the arm at the elbow up and down. Same in the feet. In the feet here, I'll grab at the distal joint and wiggle the toe up or down. If they have trouble feeling there, hold onto the ankle, onto the medial and lateral malleolus, lift it up and down. If they can't feel it there, then go up to the knee, move up and down. Same with vibration sensation. If someone doesn't feel it here at this joint, I'll move up. Do they feel it there? Do they feel it there? When do they start to feel the buzz? Same in the leg, I can go down here. Do they feel the buzz? If they don't feel it there, go up to the ankle, go up to the patella. You can even go up to the iliac crest on patients to check for that vibration sensation. Next, I test pinprick sensation. I always preface for my patients that I test the pokey sensation, but I don't break skin. I hold the hand like this, and then I'm tapping on the dorsum of the finger there. If I have a patient with a sensory complaint, I'll also make sure to test the pads of the finger. But in general, for a normal patient, I'll go with the dorsum of the finger and then just ask if they feel the poke. Comparing right, left, and then the toes. If there's any sensory issues, again, I want to trace up the limb and see when does it start to feel pokey. I'll also sometimes do a little poke on the chest to convey, this is what normal feels like. There's the normal pokey sensation. When does it become pokey like it is on the chest? Next is light touch sensation. This covers a couple different sensory modalities, but it's really useful in our patients with neuropathy. So for this, I have the patient close their eyes and I pull out just a little teeny wisp of cotton and I trace it lightly across the fingers and ask, when do they feel the cotton? And then I keep tracing upwards. If someone has neuropathy, keep going up to find out where do they regain sensation of the cotton. Tracing along the hands, up the arms, same in the feet, up the legs. So that is a complete sensory exam. So for joint position sense, there's a couple other tricks in the neurological exam to test for this. One is when I'm having the patient have their arms outstretched and their eyes closed, sometimes you can see a feature called pseudoathetosis, where the fingertips will start to float around in space. That's because they've lost joint position sense. You can even see the arms start to float in the air. Again, that's that lost joint position sense. Another trick is when their eyes are closed, have them touch their nose, and you can see if they can't quite figure out how to touch their nose right on the dime, that's another sign that their joint position sense is affected. You can also see it when testing Romberg's sign. You have the patient stand up nice and straight and ask if they feel wobbly, close their eyes, and then you'll see that sway with Romberg. So those are a couple different ways to look at joint position sensation. If I'm in the emergency department or really crunched for time examining a lot of stroke patients in the morning, there's an additional shortcut where you just focus on light touch using your fingers. So for this, you just lightly brush. And again, I want to test that distal part of the arm. If they can feel me distally, I can assume that they can feel me proximally. And I'll have the patient close their eyes. Tell me which side I'm touching.
Right, left, both.
It's important to test in that order because I'm making sure, yes, she can feel me on the right. Yes, she can feel me on the left. But if I touch both sides and she can only feel the right, that's how I know if there's neglect. I'll do the same in the arms and then on the legs. So that's kind of your shortcut when you're really crunched for time. And this wraps up the sensory exam.